I'm no more ready than I usually am.
Hail Mary,
full of grace,
the Lord is with thee.
Blessed art thou
amongst women,
and blessed is the fruit of
thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of
God,
pray
for us sinners,
now
and at the hour of our death.
Amen.
During our prayer, Catherine flipped over the most recent edition of Communio on food, of all things. The great idea. I felt particularly
encouraged.
Of course, every time they send me one, it's like, this is your last one that you like subscribe for. And I'm like, I mean, I tried to subscribe for the thing that didn't like just end every week. So I don't know what the problem is here.
What the problem is.
Quid est the problem. All right. So we are on Article 9. Interesting question about fortitude. Whether fortitude deals chiefly with sudden occurrences. So, that unexpected.
Yeah. This question is kind of taking me by surprise.
Three loves the unexpected. Just ready to go. Take it.
I'm ready to fight.
Take it. That is true. That's scary. All right. Who can begin? Do you wanna start us out here?
My phone.
Okay, thanks. Good.
Objection one. Yeah. It seems that fortitude does not deal chiefly with sudden occurrences. For it would seem that things occur suddenly when they are unforeseen. But Tully says that fortitude is a deliberate facing of danger and bearing of toil. Therefore, fortitude does not deal chiefly with sudden happenings.
So how would you summarize the objection there?
He's equating suddenness with being unforeseen and saying that, well, fortitude isn't about what's unforeseen because it has to be deliberate. So therefore, it's not about what's sudden.
Okay. Does that make sense to everybody? Got that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so basically, the man who is strong has been able to think through what his reaction is going to be. And something that happens suddenly, you don't have enough time to think through it. Therefore, it couldn't have to do with virtue in general. If virtue implies some kind of deliberation and sudden things outside of that. Let us then read the contrary.
On the contrary, the philosopher says that fortitude is chiefly about sudden dangers of death.
Wow, so not only is it about dangers of death, but about sudden dangers of death.
I answer that. Two things must be considered in the operation of fortitude. One is in regard to its choice, and thus fortitude is not about sudden occurrences. Because the brave man chooses to think beforehand of the dangers that may arise in order to be able to withstand them or to bear them more easily. Since, according to Gregory, the blow that is foreseen strikes with less force, and we are able more easily to bear earthly wrongs. And we are able more easily to bear earthly wrongs, healthy from the sick.
Well, you're missing some words there.
I don't
understand. The blow that is foreseen.
There.
You all right?
Yep.
Okay. let's try that quote.
Uh-huh.
From Gregory.
According to Gregory, the blow that is foreseen strikes with less force, and we are able more easily to bear earthly wrongs if we are forearmed with the shield of foreknowledge.
Okay, so stop right there. What is this first quality of the operation of fortitude? One is in regard to its choice. So, what has the brave man done differently from unbrave men? In what he just said here.
He's anticipated all of the terrible things that will happen to him.
That's right. He's thought about how he could potentially react. to these different situations. Foreknowledge. Because the brave man chooses to think beforehand of the dangers that may arise in order to be able to withstand them or to bear them more easily. I may have mentioned this before, but there have been scientists that speculated that that's the whole point of nightmares. Is that in your nightmares, you're facing some kind of fearful danger of death or whatever, so as to equip you in real life to be ready to stand. So this is just scientists. This was not like, but I thought that was an interesting, if providentially God allows nightmares to happen, if providentially God allows dangerous situations to arise, that in the end, you know, are not the end. So this growth of virtue and fortitude to anticipate.
What did the scientists say about if the only response you had to nightmares was to run screaming to your mommy? Does it actually build you up?
That would be the psychologist. The scientists were just speculating on the evolutionary benefits of nightmares.
I see.
People who do have nightmares might be more ready to deal with difficult situations when they are awake. So evolution has favored those who have nightmares.
Interesting.
Those strange scientific reasons. Okay, next.
The other thing to be considered in the operation of fortitude regards the display of the virtuous habit. And in this way, fortitude is chiefly about sudden occurrences, because according to the philosopher, the habit of fortitude is displayed chiefly in sudden dangers, since a habit works by way of nature.
Okay, do you understand? Could you put that in other words? What do you understand by that? And this is speaking a little bit more generally about how virtue works in us.
The habit of fortitude is executed by how you adapt to sudden dangers.
Right.
So like,
the difference
if you've actually prepared yourself for these things, if you're actually, if you actually embody fortitude, then you're able to act quickly.
Your spontaneous reaction would be one
of virtue.
Of virtue. Right, and that's a common trait for all virtues. Virtue is, when we talk about grace being like a second nature, being like a new nature that we have, virtues also are in a certain way like a new nature. It's something that perfects what, you know, in us remains kind of manipulated by our passions and by our whims and things like that. So this, as fortitude is developing in us, as with any other virtue, it becomes our new natural response. So the new natural response of fortitude, which is not bothered by it being sudden. I mean, it would only be a problem if it was sudden, if for that person it wasn't in their nature to react virtuously. So with the acquisition of the virtue, it becomes like, it takes the place of nature, it takes the place of our non-virtuous reactions, the instinct, right? Virtue begins to replace, to a certain extent, instinct, or to at least mitigate instinct. An instinctive reaction by the acquisition of virtue becomes a virtuous reaction. So even spontaneous situations do not present a problem for virtue.
Father, I'm not following, because it sounds to me what you're saying would be the opposite of this, because if virtue is like all about something that you practice over and over again until it becomes second nature, then in a sense it has nothing to do with a sudden occurrence if you've been like preparing for it all the way along. Like if fortitude was essentially, it's something you're practicing all the way along and until you need it, then how can it be about the sudden occurrence? Chiefly.
Because in this, he says it here by way of sign, right?
Yeah, by way of sign.
Yeah, it says, The habit of fortitude is displayed chiefly in sudden dangers, since a habit works by way of nature. Okay, in this, chiefly about sudden occurrences, because from the philosopher, the habit of fortitude is displayed chiefly in sudden dangers. Regards the display of the virtuous habit. The other thing to be considered in the operation of fortitude regards the display of the virtuous habit. And so, fortitude isn't just about mental strength in thinking through things, but all in that reaction. It's even in that immediate reaction. And so there's something in fortitude that has to do with a sudden, even sudden occurrences. And then especially sudden occurrences. So what I would get from chiefly about sudden occurrences is that if in a sudden occurrence you can't react in a way of fortitude, then that shows that in fact it's not a virtue for you, fortitude. It might be something that, you know, is still a habit that you're trying to have yourself do, but if in the sudden situations you don't react with that strength of mind, then that shows that the virtue's not there.
But in a situation where it's not a sudden situation, mm-hmm. you could still have as much fortitude, it's just not as clear a manifestation of it?
I think that that's what he's saying here. The other thing to be considered in the operation of fortitude regards the display of the virtuous habit. So I think the emphasis in that sentence is on its manifestation, of its coming to the surface. This way, fortitude is chiefly about sudden occurrences. Because according to the philosopher, the habit of fortitude is displayed chiefly in sudden dangers. You can see it, by the way, somebody reacts in the face of a sudden danger.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, I mean, when somebody really has poise and the calm or whatever, when the sudden danger strikes, then they manifest fortitude much more than like the muscle guy who, you know, begins by panicking when something goes wrong. And then, you know, he can kind of like muster some courage or something to get back in there. Whereas a person who's not swayed by that sudden onset of danger manifests, displays fortitude. Whereas someone who's, shows that whatever they're using, whatever inner strength that they're mustering, it's not coming from the virtue immediately.
Okay.
I think
I'm tracking with you.
Any other thoughts on that? So what was the first one?
The first what?
The first one of these two things that must be considered in the operation of fortitude.
Well, that the brave man, he thinks ahead about what could possibly go wrong.
Right.
So he's preparing. So yes, he's preparing. So is what you're saying is that in that sense, the preparation isn't about the sudden occurrence, but because he's prepared, he can withstand the sudden occurrence of danger better.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay. And the second thing is that fortitude is most clearly displayed as a virtue in the midst of a sudden occurrence of danger.
Yeah.
Like it might exist otherwise. It's going to exist otherwise. It has to, by nature of being a virtue. But you're going to see it more clearly in chiefly
mm-hmm.
in an occurrence of sudden danger.
Anything to add? That was pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Let's finish the last sentence of that. Or actually, not the last
wherefore?
Sentence. Yeah,
if you guys want, if you have your phones, we're on the ninth article of what? In the Summa.
If
you want to look it up, we're working through the Summa article on fortitude.
Right.
I just don't know if all four of us can look
it,
on the paper. You're very welcome to try.
What is it?
Yeah. Article 9 and what?
Question 1. This is
question
23. But
if you just
I
Google
see,
on fortitude, Article 9, Summa, it comes up.
Oh, Treatise on Fortitude. There we go.
Treatise on Fortitude.
Treatise on Fortitude.
Question.
And then 9th article.
9th article on the question of fortitude.
All right.
Go ahead.
Wherefore, if a person without forethought does that which pertains to virtue,
when necessity urges on account of some sudden danger. This is a very strong proof of the habitual fortitude. That habitual fortitude is firmly seated in his mind.
So we're at the end of the I answer that section.
Okay, yep. What purpose do you think that phrase serves?
It's from the Summa.
I mean, it's basically what we were saying, but just to show that
I think it,
if he can act quickly in a virtuous manner, then it shows that he is more better equipped with the actual virtue. Is that?
I think what he's saying is even in these two qualities of the operation of fortitude, foreknowledge, knowing things ahead of time, and then being able to react spontaneously. There's an order between the two. So if somebody, without having considered all of the things that they might need to do in dangerous situations, is still able to, in a sudden moment, react well, according to fortitude, then that really shows that fortitude is firmly seated in his mind. So even more importantly than thinking through all of the dangers is this, to manifest the quality of fortitude in its operation is just the suddenness of it. So it's not so much preparing yourself ahead of time that's necessary.
Question.
A person without forethought does that which pertains to virtue when necessity urges on some kind of sudden danger. It's a very strong proof that virtue is firmly seated in his mind. Last paragraph.
Yet is it possible for a person, even without the habit of fortitude, to prepare his mind against the danger by long forethought, in the same way as a brave man prepares himself when necessary? Is that a question or a statement?
I think it wasn't supposed to be a question.
It is.
It is possible for a person, even without the habit of fortitude, to prepare his mind against danger by long forethought, in the same way as a brave man prepares himself when necessary. So it's not a question.
Okay.
So it was the is it and the it is that were backwards in the text. In my text is backwards.
It's backwards. This suffices for the replies to the objections.
Or if you, maybe it is, maybe it's a statement that's just put like a rhetorical question.
I don't know. It just seems like a funny thing to say. That saying that if you think of all the dangers enough, you're going to be able to be prepared for any of them.
So maybe it's more like it might be more like a rhetorical question is formed like a statement. Is it possible for a person, even without the habit of fortitude, to prepare his mind against every danger by long forethought?
Amen.
In the same way as a brave man prepares himself when necessary. I don't know how to read that exactly.
Well,
that's
what
the Latin says.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Somebody wanted to say something.
Well, I wonder, just like thinking of the Bible verse, like when the Lord says, like, I'll give you the grace when it's like time and necessary. And so you can, I'm wondering if this is kind of like giving that thought, like you can prepare yourself and you should prepare yourself, but then also like you'll have to have the grace when you're hit.
Well, at any rate, for St. Thomas, that suffices for the replies to the objections. So why don't we look at those objections and see if that suffices for us. All right, objection one.
Is this Article 10 now?
No, we're still 9, but we're going back through the objections.
Yeah, is it me?
Yeah.
Okay. So
objection one
and then the reply. It seems that objection one, it seems that fortitude does not deal chiefly with sudden occurrences, for it would seem that things occur suddenly when they are unforeseen. But Tully says that fortitude is a deliberate facing of danger and bearing of toil. Therefore, fortitude does not deal chiefly with sudden happenings.
Okay, how would you answer that if you were St. Thomas, since he did not provide a reply to that, based on what we read?
He did not read.
There's no reply to objection one.
Oh.
Or two or three.
Oh, that's what he meant by this suffices for mm-hmm. this.
So his explanation is good enough, so we should be able to reply to these objections now.
Give me a second.
Okay.
That fortitude is a deliberate facing of danger and bearing of toil. Therefore, fortitude does not deal chiefly with sudden happenings. Well, if the brave man is deliberately facing danger, but he's facing it by preparing ahead of time, then, I don't know.
I would say it would seem really convenient that somebody had enough time to think through all of the possible dangerous situations that could arise and be prepared for them mentally. And it would make more sense that if there was a virtue that was helping man to be strong in his mind, that it would be best for the sudden things that you couldn't think about ahead of time. I mean, that would be for me the
virtue.
That would be like the best part of that virtue is that it was actually helping me in sudden situations that I wasn't mentally necessarily, quote unquote, prepared for by forethought.
Well, then what's he talking about down here? And I answer that when he says that the brave man does prepare ahead of time for
that. That's one quality, but even more importantly than thinking ahead through things is this ability, and that was the second part.
Yeah.
That I got.
Mm-hmm. Wherefore, a person without forethought does that which pertains to virtue. That part?
This is a very strong proof that habitual fortitude
is
firmly seated in his mind.
Yeah.
So it seems like the real point of the virtue of fortitude is to be able, in the sudden situations that you weren't able to think about ahead of time, to then react with mental firmness.
So it's certainly helped by foreseeing dangers as much as you can and preparing yourself mentally for it, but that's not a necessary.
If that were necessary for fortitude,
yeah.
Then it wouldn't in the end be very helpful, because who among us has been able to see everything
mm-hmm.
coming before it happens?
Mm-hmm.
And that could even be a kind of illusion, and then you've got these people who are schizophrenic or whatever, right? Psychological problems of like thinking that there is danger everywhere, lurking around every corner, predicting all the different, because it would seem that would be
okay.
A huge waste of time mentally.
So, Father, is the first, now I think I'm like now finally understanding the first objection, is it saying, Thule's basically saying, well, you're going to, a brave person or the person with true fortitude is going to see everything ahead of time and be able to deliberately buckle down and prepare for it. Is that kind of what he's saying? That fortitude is like equal to the deliberate facing of danger.
I think that in the objection that they're reading into deliberate, the objector is reading into deliberate the idea that there's some time taken to think through things.
Right.
Whereas I don't know if that's what Thule meant by
okay.
deliberate facing of danger is that it's chosen.
Okay. Thanks.
Not necessarily that he's thinking through it. But I don't know, what do you guys, any thoughts on that? Yeah, so I think that in the reply to this objection, it seems to me that what's essential is that fortitude is most important for dealing with the sudden happenings that we weren't able to foresee necessarily. And that if it can't do that, then it's not much of a virtue.
Mm-hmm.
Read all the books to be ready for all the possible dangers. I missed
Have
one.
All the night
and I missed one. And then this virtue just didn't help me at all. Okay. Let's look at objection two.
Further, Ambrose says the brave man is not unmindful of what may be likely to happen. He takes measures beforehand and looks out as from the conning tower of his mind, so as to encounter the future by his forethought. Lest he should say afterwards, this befell me because I did not think it could possibly happen. But it is not possible to be prepared for the future in the case of sudden occurrences. Therefore, the operation of fortitude is not concerned with sudden happenings. I'm having trouble distinguishing that from the first one because it sounds very much like what we were just talking
They're
about.
They're probably very much connected. I would say one of the interesting things that's coming out for me about this is almost like, I mean, I'm hearing prudence in here almost more than fortitude. Mm. It's like, you know, having the forethought to mm-hmm. think through the different things that could happen. That almost sounds more like what's proper to prudence than what would be proper to fortitude, mm-hmm. In my opinion. Prudence is, you know, the thing that's supposed to be looking at the timing and the circumstances, the right moment to act, the right place, the right way to act. Whereas fortitude is strength. And if I can't be strong when I need to be suddenly, then prudence does what it can, but if prudence can't foresee everything, I'd say that's the difficulty with Rome. So they're just too prudent. That's why it takes so long for anything to change. They take their time. No hasty decisions. Nothing hasty. Well, sometimes things happen hastily. And it seems like fortitude has got to be the virtue that's able to deal with things that happen before we're able to, quote unquote, think through it. While thinking through it can help, mm-hmm. almost seems like that's more a quality of prudence than a fortitude to me. Mm-hmm. I don't know what you guys think. Forethought, I mean, I don't know.
I mean, Thomas Aquinas did say the brave man chooses to think beforehand of the dangers that may arise.
But is that because he's prudent also?
I'm hearing what you're saying.
Or is it
yeah,
because
I don't know.
That's what makes him
he's
brave?
He's a saint.
Okay, objection three.
Well, he's referencing St. Gregory the Great, right? Anyway, sorry.
Further, the philosopher says that the brave man is of good hope, but hope looks forward to the future, which is inconsistent with sudden occurrences. Therefore, the operation of fortitude is not concerned with sudden happenings.
It's of good hope.
How would you answer that objection? Anybody, that doesn't have to just be brief.
Someday there will be peace.
Is he saying hope is inconsistent with sudden occurrences?
Huh.
Is that?
I think it's looking forward to the future.
Oh. You can't accurately look forward to the future if there are going to be sudden occurrences?
I think that that's what's implied. I don't know how...
Oh, is he saying that, okay, if the brave man is full of hope, that means that he's like in a mindset of, yeah, looking ahead to things that will happen, they will be good or whatever, but that's not the point. A sudden occurrence happens like immediately. It has nothing to do with your hope for the future. That's how I'm reading it. I don't know.
Can you not be hopeful in sudden occurrences?
Yeah, this, I mean, to me it doesn't seem like, once again, with these objections, they're not always like mm-hmm. founded on solid rational principles. Sometimes mm-hmm. there's just a bit of rhetoric in there mm-hmm. that can get you thrown off. So I don't know if hope looking to the future and the future being inconsistent with something that's happening right now. Mm-hmm. I don't know if hope is like locked into.
Because like I don't know about you, but it doesn't. When you think about it, I don't think that hope necessarily has to do with like the future. I mean, it might be like the next moment, like that future. But when I've been in a really tight situation and I'm crying out to God for help or somebody next to me or whatever, I'm hoping they'll come right now. You know what I mean? It's not like I'm hoping that they're gonna come 7 minutes from now. Like I have enough hope, like in that moment, that it would be immediate help.
Well, then I would say hope as a passion, because that's what we looked at. That's one of the ways that fortitude, you know, is it hope or is it more moderating fear and or daring, right? And then hope, didn't seem to be inconsistent with daring, because hope was looking at a different kind of object. Hope was looking at, you know,
an ultimate?
Yeah, something, an end that was, or a good that was just out of reach, but still confident in it. So hope, there is something more distant about the virtue of hope, or the passion of hope. The brave man is of good hope. But I think that that's because the brave man hopes for victory and doesn't really seem that that's inconsistent with a sudden occurrence that might want to take that away. The brave man will continue to face the obstacle or the struggle, the fear, you know, or the need to conquer that would be between him and what gives him hope, or the source of his hope. The brave man is a good hope, but hope looks forward to the future. So future, if we're looking at in terms of time, something that's going to happen later, I think we were joking earlier today, I know there will be a day of peace.
You're talking about a song that comes up in the future.
There will be a day of, I mean, yeah, in the future or now. I don't think that hope has to be something that could only be some other time, some other place, some other. So the sudden occurrence is being incompatible with the future, maybe, but with hope, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I think that's what you were saying.
I think it is. From a different angle, yeah.
But doesn't, like, hope, does have to be about the future, because I, like, hope for something that happens, and in the moment that it happens, it's no longer a hope because
mm-hmm.
it's been actualized.
Mm-hmm.
Not that it's consistent with sudden occurrences, I think that's the issue here, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Is that it affects the hope?
Mm-hmm.
Well, hope is something actual in us
mm-hmm.
that's
mm-hmm.
Affects propelling hope. Us mm-hmm. or taking us beyond the current situation, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not, that distance is not one of time only,
mm.
or necessarily of time. It's a distance simply of there being an obstacle, there being something that needs to be done first. So the hope is a more distant and a more distant good, but it's still something, that hope is something that's actual in me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and
it's like
if anything, that's a help for the brave man in the face of a sudden danger.
Yeah, because it's like a distance of perspective
mm-hmm.
so that like your action in the moment is aligned with a right perspective, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in that way it seems that hope would only be helpful to face a sudden danger rather than a cause to like, we thought he was going to be the Messiah. I mean, what happened, guys? Come on. Don't you remember anything he did? Don't you remember anything he said?
Yeah.
How slow you are to believe all that has been spoken to you by the prophets. Well, so interesting article. Whether fortitude deals chiefly with sudden occurrences. The answer?
Yes.
Chiefly. Okay, good. Chiefly with sudden occurrences. Not with only sudden occurrences, but chiefly with sudden. Let's start Article 10.
Is it me?
Mm-hmm.
Unless you want to read, Katie?
Sure. Just the first one?
Objection.
Yeah, so read the question, make sure that we know the question.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Whether the brave man makes use of of anger in his action. Objection number one. It seems that the brave man does not use anger in his action. For no one should employ as an instrument of his action that which he cannot use at will. Now man cannot use anger at will, so as to take it up and to lay it aside when he will. For as the philosopher says, when a bodily passion is in movement, it does not rest at once, just as one wishes. Therefore, a brave man should not employ anger
for his action.
Okay, what's the basic objection here? And you can jump in if you think you know, you can turn it over to everybody else if you're not sure.
The anger, because it's kind of so visceral and it comes and goes, it can't be honed to use kind of as at will. You can't just
Control your anger.
Right, you can't just make yourself angry and use it in that moment. It would be more of a kind of, it comes and goes as it will.
Okay, I think that's pretty much what I got from this objection. Mm-hmm. Anger is not something that we have a direct control over, so it shouldn't be used in something that's virtuous. Why would you mix an uncontrollable element into your virtuous action? Good objection. That was my objection. So, see what it says.
Do you want to read?
So now we skip down to the on the contrary.
I have a question though, because like in the Gospels, when the Lord gets angry, like how would you relate what you just said?
Now Christ's anger is fairly different from ours, because as Jesus takes on human flesh, he does so as God, and not with the same kind of weakness that we have towards sin. Whereas for us, anger is very close to sin. No, do not even be angry with your brother.
Yeah. Was it like that?
Some
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Jesus says
you're
that
right.
At another point.
It's right after.
Now, Jesus' anger is pure anger.
Okay, weird.
So it shows us that it's possible for pure anger to exist, but apart from Christ,
that's not weird, actually.
How pure is human anger apart from how he lives it out? So here we're looking more at the human, our experience of the passions, and then trying to acquire virtues more than Christ's experience, because we have our experience, we don't have his. But we know that he had all the passions, that was part of his human life.
Mm-hmm.
But they were different in him than they are in us. Because Christ could never be carried away by anger.
Mm-hmm.
And I think all of us, if we've been alive long enough, we know that it's possible for us to get carried away by anger. Christ, it was impossible for him to be carried away by anger. So he's coming, he has slightly, and that's really what this objection speaks to in a pretty direct way. Human beings can be carried away by anger. They are not in control of their passions directly. Christ was in direct control of his passions. He could decide to be happy or happy, joyful or sad, at will. And he didn't have it just as a reaction that he'd had no control over in the given circumstance. Christ is in full control even of his passions. So our experience is very different from that. We're not in control as far as, but I'm not in control at any rate. That's why we're trying to acquire the virtues so that we have, that we're not just led by our passions. So how does anger have a place then in fortitude? Interesting. Even for us who can be led astray, perhaps by being carried away by anger. What does he say? Who's next? So we read the on the contrary.
Do you want to go ahead and read it? Is it my turn?
If
you
yes.
Want to.
Or you,
you
can
don't have
pass
to.
And
you
pass
can
and pass.
Okay.
No, I'll give it a shot. On the contrary?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The philosopher says, am I in the right paragraph?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
got it.
So far. He does that a few times though, so we'll see what you say next.
The philosopher says, this is true. The philosopher says that anger helps the brave.
So philosophical reason. So he's not using scripture here. He's using Aristotle, basic human experience. Anger helps the brave. What does that mean? Please explain yourself, St. Thomas. Go ahead.
Would the I answer that?
Keep
you
going.
Want to keep going.
So
you
now you can
oh,
read the
okay.
I answer that.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, you want me to keep reading? Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And we may stop a couple of times through here just to make sure that we're
interrupt me. As stated above, I answer that. As stated above, concerning anger and the other passions, there was a difference of opinion between the, help me out here, peripatetics and the Stoics.
So the peripatetics, that would have been like Aristotle, Socrates, that basically, the peripatetics, the word means those who like walked as they thought.
So okay.
They would like walk around, you know, in circles and discuss things. It was their way of doing philosophy. So you've got the peripatetics, Aristotle, Socrates, and then he says in the Stoics. And the Stoics would have been those philosophers that came later and were very much focused on how you have to just accept the world as it comes to you, because otherwise you're being dumb, basically. So all the worst things that could possibly happen, just resign yourself to that, because you're wasting your energy otherwise. This is the logos of the world, Heraclitus. So anyway, so the Stoics have this idea that you just have to face life as it comes to you. Otherwise, it's a lack of wisdom. And the wisdom in life is to not be swayed, to not be moved by anything that happens. So there's a difference of opinion about the passions. The passions for the peripatetics, they understand that's part of human nature. And the Stoics say the passions need to be completely eliminated and suppressed, done away with, because they will only lead you to... I mean, the Stoics are a kind of predecessor of, like, Buddhism. And so it's like, take the full distance from anything that could cause you to react in a passionate way.
Germans, okay.
So, poor Germans. All right, keep going. Everybody kind of see that, and then he's probably going to explain that a little bit better.
For the Stoics excluded anger and all other passions of the soul from the mind of a wise or good man. Whereas the peripatetics, am I saying it right?
Peripatetics.
Peripatetics.
Very pathetic.
Peripatetics. Peripatetics, of whom Aristotle was the chief, ascribed to virtuous men both anger and the other passions of the soul, albeit modified by reason. And possibly they differed not in reality, but in their way of speaking.
That is an incredibly generous statement of St. Thomas Aquinas.
Yeah.
By the way. Possibly they differed not in reality, but in their way of speaking. Now, why would he say something like that?
Probably because the Stoics would probably still get pretty angry about things.
And those, because the Desert Fathers, most of them, had adopted an incredibly Stoic philosophy in the way that they lived out their spirituality. So as not to condemn some of the most important spiritual guides, he says, possibly they differed not in reality, but in their way of speaking. Wow. I don't ever remember reading that. That's great. Okay. Keep going.
For the peripatetics, as stated above, gave the name of passions to all the movements of the sensitive appetite. However, they may comport themselves, and since the sensitive appetite is moved by the command of reason, so that it may cooperate by rendering action more prompt, they held that virtuous persons should employ both anger and the other passions of the soul, modified according to the dictate of reason.
Okay, let's try to understand that. That's pretty subtle. Does anyone understand what he's saying there?
I think so. Well, it's just that we should be making use of our emotions, but they need to be in line with our reason.
Why would we use our emotions or our passions? Remember, he uses the specific word of passion, even though we kind of use the word emotion in a sort of interchangeable way.
He says that it's going to help action be more prompt.
And that's very interesting.
So, yeah. Whether it's... Yeah, passion of anger or love or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to act, hopefully virtuously, if it's aligned with reason, you're going to act quickly and actually respond well in that situation.
Well, it would necessarily, if it was moved by the command of reason, have so. I can use joy, I can use sorrow, I can use anger in a limited way, in order to make my virtuous action more prompt. I mean, if I'm supposed to be compassionate and I can't elicit any sadness, that's not going to be much of a virtue. If I'm
or it's just going to take, it might take you a little longer to get to the virtuous action. So it means, right?
Maybe take a bit longer, but I would say it might even be impossible to eliminate any trace of passion and be able to have, because what virtue does is it tempers, it doesn't eliminate. Mm-hmm. Tempers the greatest passions, what temperance does, right? Fortitude, it has that strength of mind even in the face of fear, great fear, or the daring. Doesn't eliminate them, but it allows you to stand even in those situations. So now, from a slightly different angle, to see how anger, because it kind of gathers your strength for the sake of correcting something that you think to be wrong, if you're right that it's wrong, and you use that anger not in an explosive way, but in a way that would move things forward quickly, if it was a virtuous action, you can see how that, but that's pretty subtle. Usually, if we allow ourselves to simply be angry or to be sad or whatever, it's not got much to do with virtue. Usually the temptation is to just let go of reason and give in to anger or sadness or joy or whatever, and to let go of reason. And here he's saying that, well, actually, as long as it's according to reason, virtue can be helped by those subtler, or by a subtle movement of the passions. So you think of, this is something that I've often thought of in boxing, because you go, we visit when we were in World Youth Day in Sydney, one of our brothers was taking a year off to live with some Anglican guy and learn about his boxing ministry. It was very strange. Anyway, so he learned, we visited them, and so it was like taking kids off of the street and teaching them to box. Well, that doesn't make much sense. I mean, these people are like being violent with each other, and now you're just putting them in boxing. And one of the things, the main things that they had to learn is to control, actually, their anger. And to not lose their reason or their focus or whatever by giving in to anger. So that, yeah, that anger, I mean, we kind of associate anger immediately with an expression of, you know, explosiveness. But that anger can be a kind of movement that can help you be quicker. If you've got to land a punch, for example. Ha! But it's one that's well calculated and thought out and to accomplish a specific purpose. And you see the younger guys that get in there and they think they've got all this energy and they're coming and they're swinging and they're angry and the person who's more experienced standing back and just lands one punch and they go down. And then it's like they have to learn that's not working. Explosive anger, not working. However, on the other side, and that's what's interesting here, that anger can help. Let's get to the end of this.
That's me, sorry.
Did we finish?
I don't think we finished the paragraph.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I need to.
Do you want to keep going?
Oh, sorry.
That's it.
Where were we?
On the other hand, I think.
Oh, on the other hand, the Stoics gave the name of passions to certain immoderate emotions of the sensitive appetite. Wherefore, they called them sicknesses or diseases, and for this reason served them altogether from
severed.
Virtue. Severed them altogether from virtue. Accordingly, the brave man employs moderate anger for his action, but not immoderate anger.
Great. Okay. So, how does he save the Stoics? How does St. Thomas save the Stoics?
Is he saying that they divided passions into two? Some of them were immoderate and some of them were moderate?
Yeah, he said he gave, the Stoics gave the name of passions in general.
Okay,
to the
immoderate
emotions.
Expressions of emotions.
So
otherwise,
I don't know if that's actually what they thought, but that's how he saves the Stoics.
That's really interesting. Yeah, they probably did. They maybe they did it without intending to.
mean, because if they called something virtue, that's essentially moderated passions.
But if you read the Desert Fathers, you'll see that the passions are pretty much not helpful, out the window. And he's saying, because for them, when they said passions, what they meant was the immoderate emotions of the sensitive appetite. That's very generous of St. Thomas. Don't know if all of the Desert Fathers really thought that. Do we have visitors? Ivana, maybe?
Maybe it's the mailman.
Somebody pushing codes?
We don't have a code box out there.
Oh, it sounded like beep, beep, beep.
It's FedEx. Okay, go on, sorry.
Accordingly, the brave man employs moderate anger for his action, but not immoderate anger. Okay, just talk about that. So let's go back through and just hit the objections and then the responses from St. Thomas.
Objection one. It seems that the brave man does not use anger in his action, for no one should employ as an instrument of his action that which he cannot use at will. Now, man cannot use anger at will so as to take it up and lay it aside when he will. For, as the philosopher says, when a bodily passion is in movement, it does not rest at once, just as one wishes. Therefore, brave man should not employ anger for his action.
How would you reply to that? Or anybody else, if you've got, before you read St. Thomas's reply, of course.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say that to the extent that you can't correct or control your passions. Certainly you can't use them towards your virtue, but to the extent that you can, which we do have the ability to, definitely not only can, but I think needs to be used to grow in virtue.
Okay. Anybody else want to add to that or see another angle? St. Thomas is sometimes surprising in the angle that he takes in his responses. Let's see what he says.
Reply to objection one. Anger that is moderated in accordance with reason is subject to the command of reason, so that man uses it at his
will.
Is that the end of it? Because I don't know.
It says at his will.
Oh, there we go. Which would not be the case were it immoderate.
Okay, so that's pretty much what you said. Very good. All right, let's look at objection two.
Would you like to?
All right. Further, if a man is competent to do anything by himself, he should not seek the assistance of something weaker and more imperfect. Now the reason is competent to achieve by itself deeds of fortitude, wherein anger is impotent. Wherefore Seneca says, reason by itself suffices not only to make us prepared for action, but also to accomplish it. On fact is, there is greater folly than for reason to seek help from anger. The steadfast from the unstaid, the trusty from the untrustworthy, the healthy from the sick. Therefore, a brave man should not make use of anger.
So Seneca is, of course, a Stoic, one of the major Stoics. Interesting. And that's from his De Ira on anger. So he wrote a book about anger. And so this is really Seneca's objection that's expressed in this objection number two. So the objection of the Stoics. And part of the objection says you shouldn't seek the assistance of something weaker and more imperfect.
Therefore the passions.
So the passions would fall in. But I mean, that is just kind of like, why not?
Yeah.
I mean, why would you not seek the assistance of something weaker and more imperfect? Certainly we see God doing that. So in a theological perspective, but even in a human perspective, if you are in charge of a household and you need someone reliably to make the coffee in the morning, I mean, you don't have to do it just because you're like the most important person in the house. Someone else can do it probably, even if they're weaker and more imperfect. So to be helped by some by something weaker and more imperfect is not necessarily against reason.
Also, though, like you were saying before, like if you want to be compassionate and you can't scrounge up any sadness towards someone else's situation, like how are you going to act compassionately, right? Is that kind of what you're saying? So it seems to me like, as I'm imagining this as like reason is like the hose that you want to point towards the garden to water. But unless you have the water like shooting out of it, right, reason is like we need to channel something. We need to send it in the right direction, right? But if we don't have like the
actual resource.
Yeah, then we can reason is in our head in a sense, right? It's like I can think all the good thoughts that I want, but if I don't have anything moving me to action, then I'm not going to actually act and do anything worth doing or like virtuous.
So first half of this, if I were to object to this objection, reply to the objection, I would say, why shouldn't something seek the assistance of what's weaker and more imperfect? I mean, that's just pride that would say you should never seek the assistance of something weaker and more imperfect.
But also, I guess what I'm trying to say is it seems to me like maybe it's not just pride, but it might actually be incorrect, because if passions can be so strong, is it accurate to say that they're weaker than reason? Do you know what I mean?
Well, yeah, in that sense, weaker doesn't make sense because passions...
Or even to say more imperfect, because if it's actually the passions that get the work done, the reason just sent it in the right direction, like it's...
I would say that the passions by themselves are imperfect, and the passions can only be perfected by reason.
But reason seems like it's lacking something too, if it's just, you're just thinking good things.
Well, reason without... love is dead. So, yeah, but love is not just passion. So there's something more to human activity than just reason. Although reason plays this important role of ordering things. And then the other half of this is a greater folly than for reason to go from anger, steadfast from the state, the trusty from the untrustworthy, the healthy from the sick. Reason by itself suffices not only to make us prepared for action, but also to accomplish it. Well, I don't know if that's completely accurate.
Mm-hmm.
If reason by itself suffices not only to make us prepared for action, which I think it does, but also to accomplish it, I don't know if reason suffices to accomplish action. I don't think that, I mean, maybe the Stoics felt that they lived that way, but I think that there's more to action than just reason. Like you said, there has to be some kind of movement beyond, and reason is more like an order than it is like a movement. Let's see what St. Thomas says.
What about, like, when St. Francis saw the man who had some leprosy or something, and his passions were like, but reason, maybe I call it reason or Christ, whatever, he knew that, like, oh, I'm supposed to embrace this man.
I think there was love in that also.
Mm-hmm.
For Christ, at the very least,
mm-hmm. Okay.
I don't think that it was just purely reason.
Mm-hmm.
When we talk about purely reason, we're thinking about, like, logical conclusions.
Mm-hmm.
We're thinking about mathematics. So when we're really saying, no, it's really just reason, then you're sort of divorcing from any other kind of movement that would be associated with it. And I don't think that St. Francis was moved by reason. I think he was moved by love. And I think that his faith spoke to his reason.
Mm-hmm.
And his faith said, is this not Christ? And he said, well, I love Christ, so I'm going to move myself. But I don't think that reason alone is enough for that. Let's read this reply. Who's our reader? Are you reading?
I think I am. Maybe. Reply to reason employs. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Reason employs anger for its action, not as seeking its assistance, but because it uses the sensitive appetite as an instrument, just as it uses the members of the body. Nor is it unbecoming for the instrument to be more imperfect than the principal agent, even as the hammer is more imperfect than the smith. Moreover, Seneca was a follower of the Stoics, and the above words were aimed by him directly at Aristotle.
Wrong thing to do. Try to take down Aristotle. Well, we are at the end of our time, so we're going to pray and then continue meditating.